Hey, it's good to be right back in the building, the fourth quarter podcast. It's always good to be in the studio, about to have some fun with my favorite person. I'm telling you, this one is the best, the mastermind of it all. That's my girl, Crystal Robbins. C-Rob, what's good?
Nothing much, Boone. What's good with you, man? How's it going? Hey, How are you feeling after the draft and all of those?
Rob, that you know what that war room is like. That war room is crazy during that time, especially leading up to what you want. If it's not there, what you gonna take? So crazy, but we feel pretty good. We feel pretty good about our pick we got in Asia Durr, who's a pretty good talent, who's gonna be a dang good pro, I believe. And then Hanju, 6'9". C-Rob, 6'9". You shoot the thing.
That's
got a nice
big
little stroke. It's gotta get a little stronger. A little back to the basket kind of game, but she's only 19. Her ceiling is high. Ceiling is high.
Yeah. I thought we had a really good draft. I'm pleased with the pieces that we picked up. We'll see where things fall and how things shake out. But Agumo, how you say her name?
Agumawale.
Agumawale is an incredible talent. I think that we added some pieces that's about hard work. And I think if your kids work hard, I call them kids, they're women.
Yeah.
If they work hard, you give yourself plenty of chances. And you know how hard it is to teach people to work hard. So,
that's probably the biggest thing that we have as coaches and field developers is just to get them to play hard. It's something that you probably shouldn't have to teach. It should probably be in each one of those players. Because this is an amazing game to play. And when you get that opportunity, boy, you got to get in there and sustain it. That's probably the hardest thing for these kids.
The first thing that players learn when they come to this league is that there just really is no night off. You know, everyone's good. You don't have a night you can rest. And it doesn't matter if something's hurting or if you're not feeling well. You know, you're required to perform. And if you don't step up and perform, it's just quite simple. The league is so good that you're going to lose if you don't come to play. So
I agree. You know, we're always talking about our WNBA players and, unfortunately, and you had a chance to coach Breonna Stewart, and it's just really unfortunate what has happened. And, you know, I was just torn apart because this is a hardworking kid, a great basketball player. You know her a lot as a person, but she tore her Achilles.
Yeah, you know, it was hard to see. But, you know, that's one of the risks that you run playing overseas, you know. Breonna is a champion in every aspect of the word. I know that she will do everything in her power to get back, as she promised that she'll be better than ever. I know that, but you know, she won every award under the sun this year. I don't know if I know anybody that has more MVPs, but since we are talking about awards, a huge congratulations is in store for you, Spoon, being inducted into the 2019 Naismith Hall of Fame, the class of 2019, a great honor, and it's one that is very well deserved.
Thanks, Rob.
So I'm happy that we get to announce that on air that you're going to be inducted and get some just due from all of the dues that you paid to this game.
Yeah, I appreciate that, Rob. That means a lot, especially coming from someone I had a chance to play with and to know and to be doing what we're doing now. You to congratulate me, it means the world to me because, Rob, I couldn't play this game by myself. I tried to be every day very an unselfish basketball player, make sure everybody else was successful out there. And that's really what it was about for me. It wasn't all about me, but when you get honors like this, you have to thank everybody else because without you guys, man, I couldn't. My name wouldn't be called.
Well, that's the truth. That is the truth. It does take your teammates, but it also it goes to speak to how hard you work and, you know, your reputation and not just impacting the game as a player. Like, you honestly made every player around you better, whether it was the energy that you provided in moments. Like, and I've tried to be that player. It is very hard saying what you did for the Liberty when I played there, because after you left, it was different. We had to generate our own energy, and it really is different when you have someone on your team that brings that kind of energy every day to support.
I appreciate that, Rob. Talking about that hard work and when people count you out and no longer believe in you. I think we can talk about somebody like Tiger Woods and what he's done in the Masters here in the Spoon Tell It section, because everybody count this guy out with his personal life. They kind of threw his personal life into his professional career. And all of a sudden, all the injuries start to occur. He couldn't really get any more wins, any major wins. And all of a sudden, this guy's putting on the green jacket, Rob. He's putting on that Masters jacket because he believed in himself when everyone else counted him out. He kept pushing through all the injuries that he had had. And now look what he's done. That's a message to a lot of people who don't believe in themselves, or people said that they don't believe in you. It's all about believing in yourself, believing in your gift, and really working at it. He had to work to get back to that status.
Yeah, he did have to work, you know, and a lot of his fans, a lot of people are calling it the greatest comeback in the history. I do and don't see it that way. It was amazing for him to see him win it after he fell from a pedestal that people put him on.
Yes.
You know, and just to be able to ignore the things that he ignored. There's a picture floating around on the internet of a guy standing there that he actually spent money to have a shirt made with Tiger's, with a picture of Tiger on it on the front. Tiger walked by him in this picture and just didn't even look at him. It just goes to show you that you just can never underestimate the heart of a champion. And if someone like Tiger falls, there's a good chance he has the ability to get himself back to the level that he fell from. That's for sure.
He did. And there's also, Rob, you talking about stuff that people have said and done. There's I guess it's a video that's out, and this man is saying everything that Tiger couldn't do, and he's just looking at him, watching and saying what he was saying, that he can't make it back. Tiger he's hurt. He can't make it. Tiger has, his personal life has caused him major problems. He can't make it. And he's sitting there looking at this video, and then all of a sudden I saw what someone wrote underneath it. The caption was, "I wonder what it feels like to eat your words. What does that taste like?" And I'm telling you, a lot of people are eating their words by saying he couldn't make it, that he wouldn't do it no more.
Well, it's just crazy to me how people lose sight of the fact that athletes are still human.
Yeah.
It's one thing to cheer for your team, and it's one thing to degrade another human being. And athletes are human too. Like, they make mistakes, they fall. We have all the same, only they're magnified. And it's crazy to me to see how many people are happy to see other people.
Yeah.
Fail. I'm really happy to see Tiger to pull it out and, you know, and get himself, not only just for the naysayers, but his kids got to experience something very special with him that I think that probably means way more to him than proving people wrong.
Right. I was in a spin class the other night, and I heard two people speaking about Tiger, and this one lady just looked at her. The girl said, "Wow, I'm really, really happy for Tiger. I think that's awesome that he came back and he won the Masters." And I was in the back of the class, and I was about to leave, and I heard this lady say, "Oh, athletes aren't heroes. They always just put them up on pedestals. They're not heroes." And I couldn't hold it. I had to say something, Rob. I was like, "Hold on one second." I said, "Ma'am, no, none of us who play this sport, none of us are wanting people to say that we're heroes, or they put these labels on us as celebrities. We're not playing it for that. We're playing it for," she said, and she stopped me in my words and said, "Oh, well, no one cured cancer. You're right. You're right. But did you ever think that someone who's sitting in those stands might be having the worst day of their life to come to watch a game of basketball, and then they see the excitement that's out there? Did you ever think one time that probably helped and changed their lives and made them see something differently?" "Oh, no, I never thought about that." No, because you guys always see us as athletes, only as athletes, that we don't know anything, we don't understand anything, that only thing we know how to do is play basketball, dribble and shut up, basically. And that was a conversation that I had this lady that I really wanted to change her mind about us as athletes.
Yeah, well, non-athletes really have a hard time getting it, I think. They have a hard time disassociating the human with the craft. I don't do well in those situations, to say the least. This is very hard for me to take it when somebody thinks it's okay to talk to me any kind of way because I'm an athlete and they're cheering for their team. It's one thing to cheer for your team, and it's one thing to attack. And I have a hard time with that. So very hard time with.
I hear you talking about being attacked, Rob. Luke Walton. I mean, the entire season, and everybody thought the Lakers were going to be, you know, in the playoffs. Just as soon as they had their lineup, they're in the playoffs. And then all of a sudden, we had a conversation in one of our episodes talking about Luke Walton and how difficult it could be for him to be coaching a superstar like LeBron. But then all of a sudden, his job is in jeopardy. He's not going to make it. There's no way he's going to be a part of this team anymore. He's gone. As soon as the season is over, he's gone. That had to be really hard and difficult for him down the stretch of that season, even try to coach that team knowing that these words are out there, these rumors are out there that he's going to be gone. But then all of a sudden, Sacramento picks him up immediately to coach their team. There has to be something that other people see in him that's pretty doggone good.
Yeah, I really do think that that stuff's all worked out behind closed doors. Yeah. You don't get hired that fast in the pros. I think that, you know, that was a process that they were going through. And I really do think that the Lakers probably had something to do with helping usher him on, because it's not that Luke Walton's been a horrible coach, right. Just a situation. And sometimes in the pros, situations take precedence to how much you know, what you know, and how good you are at what you do. You know that better than I do. So I think that Luke Walton landed on his feet, and I think that that's great for them. And it seems like everybody, almost everybody, got what they wanted or needed out of Luke Walton being moved. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens now that Magic has resigned. I don't think that is a positive for them. But hey, who am I? That's my opinion. I think that when you are Magic Johnson, like, and you're starting to make decisions, and there's other Chiefs that's probably making decisions too, you know, that's me speculating as to why he left. But that's a pretty tough pill to swallow.
I agree with you. When Magic stepped down, it was like, okay, what's going on? Something is about to occur here. But when you have someone like Magic saying that he has to walk away from it all because he wants to be himself, he didn't feel like he was being himself. He wanted to just be Magic Johnson. He wanted to be able to congratulate different players from different teams and not feel like he's tampering in any way and then causing his team some type of huge fine. But when he stepped away, I knew something was about to happen in that organization, just didn't know what it was. And then he stepped away, and then here comes Tyronn Lue. Now here, maybe Monty Williams, I believe they're thinking about. And a lot of times one coach that I think, Rob, is never mentioned for some of these jobs that might become open is Mark Jackson. He did a heck of a job with the Warriors and left Steve Kerr with a pretty good team, and now look where they are.
Yeah, I thought I saw his name floating around in some of the things that I read. Mark Jackson is a good coach, but I mean, coaching is just like anything else. Like, your players can love you for 3 or 4 years, and then one rock year, and you don't know what's going to happen. The pros is a very interesting and fragile place to go. So, you know, it doesn't matter who they pick out of those three. It could go great if they take it, and you hope that it goes great, or it could go in the opposite direction. And it's just so many outside influences on in pro sports, I think, that affect the overall outcome of the game.
Tyronn Lue being one of the people they're considering, and he once coached LeBron in Cleveland. Do you think that that could still work? Because, of course, you know, the outsiders always say that LeBron does this, LeBron does that. He makes the decisions. I don't think that he's that kind of a guy. I just can't see him being that kind of a guy.
I think that, I mean, if Tyronn Lue and him had a good relationship, and just in the clips that I saw, it looked like they did. I think it could still work. Yeah. You've played for coaches before that to this day, if you had an opportunity to go back and play for them again, you probably would. I mean, you just built that kind of rapport, and you fight for each other. And it looked like they had a good enough relationship that could happen. But, you know, that's all fine and good and dandy until some losing starts happening. When losing starts happening, somebody's going to take the blame, whether it's coach, whether it's LeBron, or whether it's the administration. Somebody has to take the blame. That's the only downside to, you know, to me taking one of these super high profile jobs. The expectations are sky high for you, and you have to find a way to fulfill them.
That's true there. And see how we're talking about the coaches and different teams, and these NBA playoff matchups have been pretty good. It has been pretty doggone good. But when you have someone like the Clippers, and as crazy as they are and how hard they play, but they're very well coached by Doc Rivers, very well coached, and he's a great motivator. Being down 31 the other night against the Warriors, the defending champions, and to watch them the way that they came back, listening to the huddle of how he was motivating his team, he was telling them, keep shooting the ball. It's going to fall. Keep defending. Keep rebounding. All those little things that he would say to them, they came roaring back. This is going to be a series. The Warriors just allowed them to see their vulnerability just a little bit. They opened the door for them to get in there. Down 31, and they come back. They come back and won the thing the way they won it. Pretty big.
Yeah, it's very, very big.
All the matchups, C-Rob, has been pretty good, though.
I'm going to tell you the matchup series that I like the most, man. Damian Lillard is just, like, that fool's range as soon as he steps in the gym. He's just jacking threes from wherever, and he's all bottom. Like, I do have on my Oklahoma City Thunder shirt today because I'm an Oklahoman, and I'm trying to, you know, give him some energy and some things like that. But I'm telling you, Portland is fun to watch. I enjoy watching them play.
It's the battle with Damian and Westbrook.
And where? Yeah, that is a crazy good matchup.
It is. I love watching it. I think the moment that Westbrook's kind of goes down and he does his little cradle rock, I think Damian's like, oh, no, I'm not dealing with that. Nah, I'm going to show you.
Yeah,
you're not rocking.
You can tell that there's a lot of competition between the two of them.
Yeah.
And, watching them play is fun. And, you know, you just don't see many nights where Russell just doesn't shoot the ball.
Right.
Decent, you know, and he shot the ball very poor. And, you know, you got to attribute some of that to Dame. Like, his defense was good, and he's making Russ expend a lot of energy, like, in certain instances, trying to guard him. It's a fun matchup to watch. That's my favorite matchup, actually.
Mine too.
It's just crazy to look at the list of names in there, and it's just a whole bunch of different names that ain't normally here at this time of year in the playoffs. So it's just interesting all the way around.
You're talking about not normally there, the Brooklyn Nets. I've watched them all year long. I kind of like that young crew. They got a chance to beat the 76ers. The 76ers stay as inconsistent as they are throughout these playoffs. They'll get them. They'll beat them. That's the one team that they could sneak in and get them.
You talk about, you got Toronto and Orlando. That series is tied 1-1.
Yep.
It's just a bunch of people, you know, besides Golden State. Houston's there. But, you know, and then San Antonio, Old Faithful, finds a way to get there. They find a way to get into the playoffs every year. But, you know, other than that, it's not the normal Lakers and the Miamis and the people who you're used to seeing in the playoffs. So I think it's interesting, and I think it's good for the league.
I do too, Rob. You get to see some of these people who normally don't get an opportunity to even play on TV as much as all the other guys that normally on the NBA League Pass. Now you're really getting to see them play in that light and getting to see what these athletes really are all about. And what a place to see it in the playoffs and how hard everybody plays and what the playoffs really mean. Every game has a great meaning because you better put it all out there, because once one team get a little bit of momentum, that momentum is really hard to stop. And that's when upsets start to happen.
Yeah, that's true. And these young guys, they seem to be able to run forever. You know, these younger guys that just, you know, in the playoffs for the first time, and the excitement of it, and, you know, it's just fun to watch. It's fun to watch, and, you know, you'd like to see a lot more parity happen in that league. And I think that you're starting to see these young players, it doesn't matter what their names were coming out of college, they're coming into the league like gangbusters.
Yeah. That's a huge difference from times before. And I was talking with Robert Horry earlier today, and that's something he spoke about too, was they coming in and they're looking to make their name. They're not just walking in, I made it, I'm here. They're looking to make their name and make their mark in this league.
Yeah. And what better place to do it than in the playoffs?
Yeah.
What better place to make a name for yourself at? The drama of TNT in the playoffs.
Right, all those eyes up on you. Yeah. All of them.
Yeah.
We ain't upset about it, though.
No, I'm not upset about that. But I am upset about something. And
you know, I can't wait to hear it.
The dead horse. It's being a dead horse. But I'm really upset, Spoon, that somebody don't have enough sense to take our president's phone and stop letting him tweet some of the things that he tweets, man.
Oh, my God.
All the things that's going on right now in politics in general,
yes.
The unrest, the fighting, the amongst us as Americans with each other.
Right.
I can just imagine another country sitting on the sidelines watching us fight over menial things that really are not grand things in the scope of things. So I'm upset. Like, I almost hate to turn on CNN. I almost hate to turn on, open some kind of social media. What it boils down to is going to be somebody bashing somebody. Whether it's Democrats, Republicans, Donald Trump bashing, that the tweet that he sent out with a Muslim lady and saying, we'll never forget 911. I don't know how much more inappropriate that can be and that people defend it. So I'm upset about that.
You have every right to be upset about that. I can't watch anything that he does. I can't. Anything that comes on, I turn it. Because like you said, it's inappropriate. What president sits and tweets all day, all night, and then the things that he's tweeting about. It just doesn't make sense. And I'm just as upset about those things as you are. And I'm really upset today, too, because of this New York traffic. Oh, my goodness. Makes no sense that at this early time of the day, you can't get anywhere. You can't get anywhere. And it was tough on me to get to set today. Like, New York City traffic. Chill, please. Chill out. Everybody working.
Because New York City traffic ain't going to let you be great. Like, what are you talking about? It ain't letting nobody be great. Because I'm going to tell you, one thing that is a constant is going to be there. And you just never know. Like, think you leave at that time of day and you're going to get there. But you just never know once you get out there and get in it.
You never know. It's the most amazing thing to me. I'm like, okay, I'm normally good at this hour. So let me get out of here. Boom, get out. Well, traffic. And then what I'm used to is everybody driving crazy when there's a moment of freedom. Everybody's going slow today. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to get a ticket today. I'm moving. But once again, the traffic, like you said, wouldn't let me be great. Wouldn't let me be on time. But I'm here.
But you made it. You made it.
It was tough, but I made it. You know, Rob, we're talking about all the teams and the coaching and all this stuff that we talk about. But when we're talking about these teams and how these teams conduct themselves, what the organization looked for, and this was something that we could probably talk about when we were in the war room and checking to see what players we were looking for and the culture that we had built. Do those players have those characteristics? Do they have those to be a part of the culture in which your team or your organization has created? That's something I have to speak about all the time, especially about the New York Liberty and how we were and the things that we thought was the most important thing for us. And it's about building that culture and the importance of it in an organization. It is important to have that type of culture. And if you can't find those players who fit that culture, fit those characteristics that you're looking for, there's no need to even look for them. That's the one thing I learned from Pop. He says, I don't care how good you are, if you don't fit in to what we're doing here in our culture, there's no need to even look at you.
Well, I think culture is probably the single most thing in a successful organization, whether it's basketball, whether it's a Fortune 500 company. The culture takes precedence over individuals. I think that people will succumb to the culture. Like, I love being a part of the New York culture as a player because, if we couldn't beat you, we might beat you up. You knew that when you came to play us, you were coming for a fight. Like, it wasn't going to be an easy game by any means necessary. So I think the culture is one of the most important things that in an organization, because individuals will tend to defer a little bit to culture and associate with a certain kind of culture.
Yeah.
Speaking of culture, the culture is taking over America, hip-hop culture. Black, white,
right.
Asian, whatever, everybody's with the culture. And it's crazy how the culture influences you to want to be a little bit better. for that culture.
Right, want to be a part of that. When you see great teams, or like you said, culture period, when you see that, you want to be a part of that, especially when you know it's good for you and it's impactful for your life. You want to be a part of it. Anybody wants to be a part of a team that has that great culture, and there's a level of consistency that you see each year with that team or each year with that organization, whatever it might be that you're looking at. But that culture has always played a tremendous difference when anybody's looking to be a part of a team. Culture matters. It definitely matters.
Yeah, well, if your culture is good, it leads your players down the right path. And I think that's something that our team that I just went signed with, that we're going as a major issue for us, is the culture is going to have to be addressed. It's going to have to be changed. It's going to have to be consistent, mm-hmm. because if it's not, the culture changes every time a new best player comes in. And then you're, as a coaching staff, you're susceptible to that person and how they carry themselves and how they conduct themselves. And you're hoping and wishing that, you know, hopefully they just are good people. But you don't want your culture to change like that every year. You want your culture to be consistent, and the people coming to your culture, they got to change to fit into the culture. The culture has to be bigger than you. And usually on successful teams, the culture is bigger than the individual. I
totally agree. And speaking of culture, see, Rob, we're talking about a lot of times hiring women on NBA staffs and positions. We talk about that a lot and how important that is to reinforce a strong culture as well in teams. And you see it happening. Of course, our little sister Becky Hammon got it started on that end by getting in first. But that is also an important thing for the knowledge of women stepping into roles in the NBA, whether it's on court or in the front office of NBA teams and organizations. That culture must change too, I think. I think more women need to be a part of that, or even acknowledge a little bit more of what we can do on that side as well, because we seem to bring in a lot of men on our side of the WNBA, and they're a part of what we do and how we do it. We have that same knowledge, and we're able to give that same thing on the NBA side as well, if that's a dream of a lot of people.
Yeah, I really do agree with that. I think that culture just plays a role in everything. Like, culture makes recruiting go. Culture is one of the biggest things in your team that don't have anything to do with X's and O's. And when people fall in love with the culture and they associate with it and they kind of live that culture and everybody's dedicated to it, it's, and I'm going to tell you, Seattle Storm has a culture that is impeccable, and it starts with Sue Bird. Sue's been there for a long time. And if you don't come in there and fit into that culture, you're not going to be in it. You're not going to be there for long. Sue has, I don't want to say she created the culture there, but she's was there at the start of the culture, and I know what the owner's culture, what they want the culture to be, and Sue falls right in line with that. And anybody who doesn't come in there and fit in with that is going to struggle there.
Right. Well, you know, that I always go back to how we were, because we expected anybody that came in on our team, we expected them to fall in line with our culture. If that didn't happen, it was no need to be a part of what we're trying to do. Because it's almost like you kind of isolated yourself because you weren't a part of what we do. Because all of us were connected. We were connected into that culture, and we weren't moving from it. And anybody that came into it, we wanted them to be a part of the culture. And if you couldn't fit into that, you couldn't check all those boxes off, you knew that this wasn't a team for you. And that's the way we conducted ourselves, and it truly mattered. And that's why we feel like we were tremendously successful. Nobody really wanted to play against us because, number one, we're going to defend your butt. Number two, we're going to beat you no matter what we got to do to get a win. We're putting it on you. And number three, we're going to do it together. We're going to do it together. Yeah. We had all the characteristics, you know, in place. Everything was in line. We had it all in line. We didn't fall away from that. We never wavered. We stayed with that every single year. And I agree with you totally. It has to be consistent. You can't change that, because every time that you create that culture still remains relevant even the next year. It remains relevant.
And anytime I think teams go to a culture change, the teams suffer for a while. The culture's changed a lot in New York.
Huge point. Right.
They've won some games, but it's been different in New York. And I think that, you know, the fans there have a certain type of basketball that they like to see. And we definitely did a good job of giving them that, but it all did go back to culture. And it's really funny how I think we mirrored the Knicks at that time, when Latrell Sprewell and those guys all played there. they kind of had the same kind of culture we did.
I agree with that, Rob. We were just like a sister brother kind of situation. We were darn near mirrored every single thing about the Knicks. That was like our big brothers. You know, a lot of times, see, Rob, about our players now, especially in the NBA, especially when you talk about KD, a lot of times when they decide to make a decision of their own and do what they must do for themselves, and the thing that's probably questioned a lot is they become villainized as players and like, oh, I can't believe you're doing this. I can't believe you're leaving this situation to go into this situation. But the question will always be, why isn't it the same way when an organization decides to trade that player away? Why isn't it the same thing?
That's an argument that makes me really, really mad. Like, and really makes me mad when common people have a comment to make about a player not being loyal to an organization. As soon as you get to an age where they feel like they can't get anything out of you or your value is dropped, the team is going to do what's best for them.
Absolutely.
So why are you holding me to a standard that the team's not held to? Like, if there's another team that places more value in me, why am I disloyal because I'm going to go do what's best for me? I promise you the team's going to do what's best for them when it comes down to
Absolutely.
It. Absolutely. So that whole talk to me is asinine. Like, until I start seeing more organizations be like San Antonio and be like Dallas that are really loyal to the people who have destroyed their bodies for them, then to me it's just talk.
Right.
Because organizations are going to do what's that's going to affect their bottom line. Why shouldn't athletes do what affects their bottom line?
Right. And I think, Rob, we've all been part of not feeling that loyalty from an organization. We've all kind of felt it. And it doesn't feel good, especially when you know you gave every single thing you had. You were loyal every time you put that uniform on. You represented yourself first. If you can't represent yourself, you can't represent an organization. You represented yourself well, and then you represented that organization extremely well. Never any talks at all. But the moment, like you said, they feel like you can't do anything no more, or you've up in age now, oof, you're gone. But you can't make a decision for yourself and decide, well, let me see if I can change some things for myself right now. Oh, you do that? You're not loyal. You weren't loyal to this program. You weren't loyal to this organization. Nothing. It just seems like it falls down on your shoulders so heavy that it makes you start to like, dang, should I have done that? But it really isn't about loyalty. And now, see, Rob, the more I look at it, I'm like, even when as a head coach, I never looked. People say, what do you look for first? I didn't look for loyalty. I look for commitment to my vision. I want commitment to the vision. If I have commitment to the vision, I think down the line I would gain that loyalty. I kind of learned that on my own in my head coaching position at Louisiana Tech. I was looking more for commitment to the vision.
Well, I think with your players, that's all you can look forward to, because if you can get them to be committed to the vision, because as long as you're doling out playing time and anybody that's not getting what they want, and that's the thing that's hard about the pros, because if you make your best players mad, whether you're in the right or wrong or indifferent, and you start to have a bad relationship with them, it's not long before you're not going to have a job.
True.
That's just a matter of fact. But I mean, I've watched it. I've seen it more than once in this league in my eyes. There was no loyalty coming from the organization, not even a little bit. But the player always gets vilified for trying to find a situation that's best for them and their family. So that's an argument that I don't even like to have, that I usually get mad, especially if someone brings it up that don't really know things about it.
And you're right. You should be mad, Rob, because no one should have anything to say when somebody's going to do what's best for them and their family. I don't think anyone should have anything to say. Not anybody that you played with. Didn't have anything. You should understand that person is doing exactly what they must do to better themselves and their family. Other than that, why are we questioning it? It is what they got to do.
It's when it boils down to it, it's a business decision. It ain't personal. You're going to do the best business decision for this team, and I'm making the best business decision for me. and I don't understand why people get mad about that.
Right, Rob.
At all. If you value me, then you'll pay me the same thing, or you'll do the things that the other teams are offering to do. It's totally that simple.
Totally agree. You know,
you have treated me properly, I might even take less.
Because
I like where I'm at.
You just said it.
The culture is so good. But
you said it. You mixed that in real well, Rob. Yeah. Yeah. You know, we talk about a lot of things, so we like to always wind down, especially with our MVPs. I know I'm definitely gonna go first because I mean I experienced something today that was just unbelievable. I had a chance to be a part of the dual language middle school this morning, and when I tell you, I was truly inspired by these young people in this school who dual language. They actually speak Spanish and English, and those that come from an English speaking home must learn Spanish. Those learn from Spanish must learn English. It was absolutely amazing of how those kids walk into that school and the way they conducted the school. It was amazing. It was amazing. I've never seen a school so organized. It was so organized with those kids, and it was beautiful. I mean, I had such a great time. It's just hard for me to explain how it was because those kids could do so many different things. And when you walk up and you ask them, okay, you need me to help you here? Oh no, I have it. They wanted to do it themselves. They wanted to show you that they have it. They trusted and believed in themselves. And that started from the principal there at that school who teaches those kids that they can do whatever they wish to do. And if they sit and they learn, they listen, it's amazing what they can accomplish. And those kids were absolutely amazing. And at Dual Language Middle School, they are my MVP for today.
Okay. Well, that is really cool. Well, my MVP for the day actually happens to be you because you're getting inducted into the Naismith Hall of Fame. Man. I do think that that is a very, very big deal, Spoon. And, you know, I don't know if you understand how many lives you impacted. When I came to Liberty, I mean, I could score a little bit, I could shoot a little bit, but, you know, I learned so much just about teamwork, and I learned some of them in the hard knocks way, like getting knocked down a lot. I think that I learned that if you want something really bad, you better be willing to stand up and fight for it. You taught us how to show compassion. You led us in a way that players like Bernadette Ngozi that came from Africa, when, you know, you like, let's all put our per diem together so we can buy her some clothes, because she didn't have clothes. And you just went out of your way for all of us when we needed you. And that, it didn't mean that I had to be best friends with you. You and I always laughed together, but away from basketball, it's not like we spent every day together or anything like that. We had a lot of laughs together, but you looked out for everybody on your team. And that's what makes you the real MVP, because you take care of the people around you.
Ooh, Rob, you did me wrong right there. You about, man.
It's going to even be worse when you get up there and you look out there and you see all your family sitting out there and they got to come along for this ride with you. And you're at a loss for words, but you deserve to be right there. I'll never forget the first time I met you at that stupid 3-on-3 tournament. You and Chantel and somebody else beat me and a couple of New Zealand girls in the finals of that 3-on-3 tournament. I can honestly say I was scared to death of you at that time. And you kind of punked me a little bit. Some days it's over. I don't get punked no more.
There you go, Rob. You got to kill me. You know, I ain't think you're going to do me like this. And I can't even look up right now. You don't understand how much I appreciate your words. It's something that, see, Rob, it's hard for me to even wrap my mind around. And those words mean so much to me. And trust me, I will never let those words leave me. I will take those words and I will tuck them away, because those words make me who I am. And I'm glad that you could see who I am, not only as a basketball player, but as a person. And I appreciate your words, Rob. I love you. I love you. I love you more.
Okay, well, dry the tears up, boy, before I smack you on the butt. And it's a rat. Y'all check me out at CRobert3 on Instagram, and I'm CRobert3 on Snapchat too. That's where I really get lit at, y'all, on Snap.
You got it. You know, you can take a look at me at Teaspoon_11 on Instagram and on Facebook. My full name, Teresa Weatherspoon, not Wither, but Weatherspoon. Once again, we thank you guys so much for tuning in at the Fourth Quarter Podcast.
Thanks, appreciate guys.
You. Much love, Rob.